Everlasting Arms. It's on in the hymn book at 75. Trust and Obey, and it's on hymnal 571.
Frown or a cross, but this blessing we trust in. trust and obey. But we never can prove the delights of His love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor He shows and the joy He bestows are for them who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Our next song is "You Are My Hiding Place," and it's on page 700 in our hymnal.
That's the right one. Good job.
Okay.
Sanctuary.
to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary.
To come to this place, worship you, praise you, Lord, learn about your word and encouraging us all. I pray, Lord, that you'll be with Pastor Rick today as he gives us a message. Let it dwell in our house, in our hearts, in our house of our being, Lord, that we can spread your will, spread your word, and do your will. And I ask this all in the loving name of Jesus. Amen.
Well, we're still in the book of Genesis. Today we're on chapter 41, Genesis chapter 41. As we continue looking at the life of Joseph and how to live a victorious life, taking examples from Joseph's life and today we're looking at maximizing your life. How to get the most out of your life. So far we've seen Joseph as he was sold into slavery by his brothers who were jealous of him. And that certainly is a lesson for us to learn. Jealousy, envy will lead to bitterness, which eventually will lead to even more dangerous things. In Joseph's case, it was his brothers that were jealous of him and envious. His father showed favoritism to Joseph, and that's another lesson to learn. Parents, don't show favoritism in your family to your children. It'll cause envy and jealousy with others and eventually cause a lot more problems. And that's what happened with Joseph. They threw him in a pit, then they took him out, sold him to Ishmaelites who took him off to Egypt and sold him to Potiphar. And then he was falsely accused of attempting to rape Potiphar's wife, and he was thrown into prison. Falsely accused and thrown into prison. Now, I've heard this a lot. I've been in jail a few times myself. Not behind the bars. I was on the right side of the bars. I was there acting as a chaplain and visiting with those who were incarcerated, also in juvenile detention homes. I've heard this story before. I'm innocent. I don't deserve to be here. And in a lot of those cases, I found out that just wasn't the case. In Joseph's case, it was. He was totally innocent had been falsely accused, and instead of Potiphar asking what his side of the story was or looking into it deeper, he just got upset and threw him into prison. And then we read or studied about how Potiphar's or the Pharaoh's butler and butcher were thrown into prison there with Joseph, and they had dreams. And Joseph was able to interpret their dreams only by the grace of God. God is the one that interprets dreams. Joseph said that. God is the one that interprets dreams, not me. That's another lesson to learn. Whatever you do, give glory to God. Don't take the glory yourself. Be humble, not prideful. So he interpreted their dreams, and on one of them he said, in 3 days, Pharaoh's going to let you out and going to reinstate you into your former position as my butler. And then he said to the baker, in 3 days, you're going to get out of prison. Now, you know, he heard that. He probably felt really good about that. But then he told him, and then they're going to hang you. Well, that wasn't so pleasant news either. And you know what? It happened exactly like that. 3 days, they both were released. And Joseph told the butler, he says, now, when you come into Pharaoh's presence, remember me, you know, bring my name up before Pharaoh. I'm sure he said, I'd like to get out of this place. And I'm sure he would. And so we don't know exactly how long he was kept in prison. Obviously, the butler went out and he forgot about Joseph, didn't mention him to Pharaoh. But we know he was there at least 2 years, for 2 years after he interpreted their dreams. 2 long, uneventful years, Joseph waited on the Lord. He waited on the Lord. There's a passage of scripture in Psalms chapter 27, verse 14. It says, wait on the Lord. Be of good courage. He shall sustain your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. I think Joseph knew that in his heart. He had a relationship with God. And when we're talking about how to get the most out of your life, how to maximize your life, it's got to start with a right relationship with God. And a right relationship with God is only available through a relationship with Jesus Christ. Because that's what he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. It's only through Jesus Christ that we have access to Father God and the Creator, our Creator God. And eventually and that's how we begin to maximize our life, to get the most out of our life. You know what the most out of my life is? Knowing that despite all the chaos that's going on in the world today, and reading, and as we've studied the book of Revelations here last year, and knowing what is in the future, what's coming down the pike, I'm ready. I know where I'm going. I know that I have a home in heaven. That's what Jesus said. I go to prepare a place for you. And then I'm going to come again and take you into myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And certainly we've read how Christ is going to come again. And it's not going to be too far in the future. With all, you look at what all is going on. And it seems like every day, it's like there's a well-known chef, Emeril Lagasse, and he's always, his favorite thing is, boom, kick it up a notch, right? Bam, kick it up a notch. Well, I'll tell you what, every day it's being kicked up a notch. Are you ready? Are you ready for that day when Christ will come again? Joseph knew in his heart that God would give him the strength to get through. Also, in 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 6 and 7, Peter writes this, "In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, to honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ." Joseph spent 2 more years in prison, at least. Why? Well, that's what Peter tells us, that we should rejoice. That when we experience these various trials, it's there to test the genuineness of our faith. And I'll tell you something. Our faith is more precious than gold. Gold will perish. You can have all the gold in the world, but it'll go away. You can be the richest person in the world, own all the wealth there is to own, but when you die, it's nothing. The only thing you're going to have is what's in your heart. What's in your heart? Joseph's time in prison, listen, was not pleasant. Even though he was in charge because of being blessed by God, he was in charge of the affairs of the prison, he was still a prisoner. He was unable to come and go as he pleased. And his life in prison, which was a lot different than his Pharaoh's butler or Pharaoh's baker, those are the ones that Joseph was assigned to serve in prison while he was there. In fact, in the book of Psalm 105 tells us about Joseph's imprisonment and his release and his rise to power. Psalm 105, verses 17 and 18, listen to what it says. It says, "He," talking about God sent a man before them, Joseph, who was sold as a slave. They hurt his feet with fetters. He was laid in irons. He was thrown into prison. He suffered. After 2 long years, God causes Pharaoh to have a couple of dreams. And in the first dream, Pharaoh is standing on the bank of the Nile River, and he sees 7 very fat, healthy cows suddenly come up out of the river. And what do? They start grazing on the riverbank. And then he sees 7 very sickly looking, malnourished cows. They come up out of the river. And what do? They eat the fat ones. And then Pharaoh wakes up. Man, if I had a dream like that, when I woke up, I'd be a little concerned. I'd be a little worried. So then Pharaoh finally was able to fall back asleep, and he has another dream. This time he sees 7 heads of grain on one stalk, And each head was firm and well formed and plump. Seven more heads that were shriveled up and withered, they suddenly appear on that same stalk. They swallow up the plump heads of grain. And again, Pharaoh wakes up. Very troubled at these dreams. And he searches all over Egypt for the wisest of men he can find, but he could find no one who was able to interpret his dreams. And then his butler, "Ah, I know a guy. I know a guy. His name is Joseph." So he tells Pharaoh about Joseph and Joseph's ability to interpret dreams. Why did this happen? Well, listen to what Proverbs 21:1 tells us. "The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. Like the rivers of water, he turns it wherever he wishes." And in the events to follow, in Joseph's experience, we can learn two actions that we need to take in order to maximize our life, in order to get the most out of our life. Number one is this. Plan for the future. Plan for the future. So, Pharaoh hears the testimony of his butler, his chief butler, and he sends for Joseph. Now, Joseph understands he's been summoned to go before Pharaoh. He is going to meet the guy, the head honcho of all of Egypt. And so what does he do? He shaves, he changes his clothes, and he goes to stand before Pharaoh. He wants to look his best. Pharaoh tells Joseph that he says, I heard from my butler that you interpret dreams. Is that true? And what does Pharaoh tell Joseph? Nah, it's not me. God shall give Pharaoh an answer of peace. So God's the one that has the ability. God's the one that allows me to do this. I'm not doing it. God's doing it. He's just using me as an instrument. Joseph makes it very clear that God will give him the ability to interpret Pharaoh's dreams. I think that's a very good example of a principle that we learn from God's word in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31. 1 Corinthians 10, 31 says this, "Therefore, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God." Do all to the glory of God. Everything I do in life, I owe it to God. The talents that you have, the gifts that you have, they're from God. God gives those to you. Give Him the glory. Give Him the glory. And all that you do, whether you eat, whether you drink, whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. So, like Joseph, whatever gifts or whatever talents we have come from God. So, if you're skilled in sports, give God the glory. If you are skilled, and I've seen this in math, boy, some folks can just pump out figures and numbers off the top of their head, and then some of us, we have to figure it all out get the calculator, get some machine that's smarter than we are, figure it out. But listen, if God has given you that gift, and whether it's math, whether it's working with computers, Brian is a techie. In fact, in my opinion, I think Brian is the techie of the techies. You know what? Brian didn't get that on his own. It's a gift of God. Give God the glory. And maybe your gift is in teaching. Or maybe you're a politician. There's some good politicians out there. Don't just down them all. There are some good politicians. I'm looking to meet one, but there you go. And there's one local politician that we have. Emily is her name. McIntyre, yes. Yeah, I know that family quite well. Yeah. So if God is gifting you in whatever area He has gifted you in, give Him the praise and the glory, just like Joseph did. Joseph said, God is the one that does this. Pharaoh then tells Joseph about these two dreams that he had concerning the cows and these stalks of grain. And he explains, Joseph then turns around and explains that those two dreams, Pharaoh, even though one dealt with cows and one dealt with grain, they both have the same meaning. He says, Pharaoh, there's going to be 7 years. 7 years of plenty. But it's going to be followed by 7 years of famine. And then he tells Pharaoh that the reason he had those dreams with the same meaning is that God has declared that these events are going to happen really soon. Really soon. And then he makes a suggestion to Pharaoh. He says, Pharaoh, you need to find the wisest man in the land. You need to put him in charge of a nationwide feeding program or nationwide storage program, that he'll store 20% of all the food produced during the 7 years of good. And that plan, he said, would provide enough food for the 7 years that they would go through famine. You know, there's a lot of verses in the book of Proverbs that teach us that planning ahead is part of being wise. Folks, planning is being wise. For example, we're told to consider the ways of the ant. In Proverbs chapter 6, verses 6 and then in verse 8, it says, go to the ant, you sluggard. There's a lot of people who are like sluggards, you know. They're lazy. They don't want to plan anything. They just, I'll just take one day at a time. One step, you know, whatever comes, comes, and I'll deal with it when it comes. And it says, go to the ant, you sluggard. Consider her ways and be wise. And then he says, she provides her supplies in the summer and gathers her food in the harvest. And like ants, we need to plan for the future. We need to plan for the future in our finances. We need to plan for the future in our careers, in our retirement. Folks, when you fail to plan, you plan to fail. Did you get that? If you fail to plan, you plan to fail. Now, there's another area we need to plan for the future. I think it's the most important area in our whole life. And that is in our spiritual life. In our spiritual life. Where are you today in your spiritual life? What is your relationship with God today? See, the Bible said, Jesus said this, except a man be born again, he shall not see the kingdom of heaven. We need to plan for the future. We need to get it right now. You know, our life is but a vapor. That's what the Bible teaches. It's like, it goes that fast. And you know, I've noticed this. The older I get, the faster it goes. I have no idea. I remember growing up and I was saying, boy, I wish I would hurry up and become an adult. And now I look back and say, where'd all those years go to? My wife will ask me, she'll ask me a question about, you know, how long ago this happened? I says, just last year, a couple of years ago. She says, no, it's been 10 years. I said, are you kidding me? 10 years? Woof. Time flies fast. And sometimes we think, and you know, the problem with young people today is they think they have forever. So they're not planning for the future. Sometimes they're living wild, grabbing the side of cars while they're on their skateboard, living wildly. We got to plan for the future. What's your relationship with the Lord today? Have you accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior? If you haven't, you can. The Bible says, you know, it's all a matter of the heart. It's what's in your heart. The Bible says, with the heart, man believes unto salvation. With the mouth, confession is made to salvation. So, in order to maximize your life, to get the most out of your life, begin with the right relationship with God. Plan for the future. Plan for the future. Secondly is this. Listen. Ban or get rid of, if you want to use that word, if you will, get rid of or ban the pain of the past. Pharaoh, here Joseph presents this whole scenario to him, and Pharaoh is so impressed with Joseph's plan that he appoints Joseph to be in charge of the entire land of Egypt. It's interesting to me that Joseph goes, as Chuck Swindoll once said, from pit to pinnacle. He was in the pits one time. And next time we see him, again, later on in life, he's at the pinnacle of life. He is now, and Pharaoh places the ring on his finger. Now, ring was used to make impressions in soft clay or wax, and it was used as Pharaoh's seal on official documents. So what did it do? It gave Joseph the power and the authority that Pharaoh had. Pharaoh was the second highest person in the whole nation of Egypt. Second only to Pharaoh. Pharaoh also provided Joseph with some new clothes. And a gold chain to wear around his neck. And he also had Pharaoh to ride in his second chariot. He did that so the people would pay homage to Joseph. And finally, he says, Joseph, I got a gift for you. I'm going to give you an Egyptian wife. So he gave him a wife from a very prestigious family, by the way. She was the daughter of the priest of On. I think Pharaoh is doing everything he can, doing the most that he can do to Egyptianize Joseph, if you will. So, how old is Joseph now? He's 30 years old. You think about this now. 13 years have passed since his brother sold him into slavery. And God used those years of adversity in his life to really accelerate his maturity and to sharpen his character. That's what adversity does in our life. When there's adversity in our life, it accelerates our spiritual growth. Joseph's problems were not a chain of events that was generated by bad luck. You know, you must have had some bad luck in your life. No. The pit, Potiphar's wife, the prison, that was all part of God's plan for developing Joseph's character. So the question is, why did God allow Joseph to become a slave, to become a prisoner before he elevated him to the second most powerful man in the world? I was thinking about that, and it came to me. Luke, the 16th chapter of Luke, in verses 10, the first part of verse 10, it says, "He who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much." It's a testing. Sometimes we go through that testing period. How faithful are we in the least of the things that we're given? And if you're faithful in that, you'll be faithful in much more responsibility. I remember the first job I had when I came to, got out of the military, came here, had a job as electronic technician, repairing old-time televisions in where you had the big picture tubes, you know, had to replace a lot of those, and you just replace tubes. Nowadays, you just throw them away and buy a new one. But I left that company and I went to work for another company. I started out as a shipping and receiving clerk.
Sounded right the first time.
Yeah, sounded right the first time. After working at that position for a little while, the boss says, "Hey, I'd like for you to move up to become a inside salesperson to work the counter." So I did. And I did the best I could. And then I got a call saying, "Hey, we want you to be an outside sales rep for the company." And I says, "Okay." So my responsibility was all of Southern Oregon, Northern California. That's where I traveled. I was gone a lot. In fact, people ask my wife, we've been married like 51 years now, and people ask my wife, says, "Man, how did you put up with him all those years?" She always said, "Well, he's gone a lot. Now I'm home a lot," which is good. And then I got a call one day saying, from the vice president of the company, saying, "Hey, Rick, your manager just submitted his resignation. And we've been watching you over these years that you've been working with us, and we would like for you to become the manager for all of Southern Oregon, Northern California." And it's because of the grace of God, because of God had given me that gift of talking with people and that being faithful in those little jobs. That's what we need to do, folks. Be faithful in the little things that you're made responsible for, because it shows then that you can be faithful in the larger things. And that's so important for us. Joseph, listen, Joseph was faithful as a slave. He was faithful as a prisoner. So there is no doubt that he would also be faithful as the prime minister, if you will, of the most powerful nation in the whole world at that time. Egypt was. The next seven years produces so much grain that the storage bins are overflowing. Because the Bible tells us that the grain there was like the sand of the sea. So much of it. Joseph very wisely stores the grain, and he does it not just in one place, but he stores it throughout all of Egypt so it would be accessible to everyone in the land. So before the year of famine arrived, those years of famine arrived, Joseph then has two sons. And he gives them Hebrew names. Even though he's married to an Egyptian, they have two children, he's given them Hebrew names. And these names that he's giving them reveals his faith in Jehovah God to keep his promises. The firstborn son, he names Manasseh. The Hebrew word, it means forget. Joseph chooses the name because in his heart he is willing to forget the wrongs that he had suffered and the misery that he has gone through being separated from his family. Now, that doesn't mean, guys, that Joseph has forgotten the pit or forgotten the Potiphar's wife or forgotten prison. He hasn't forgotten the betrayal, those false accusations, the humiliation that he has suffered, and the loneliness. He can never forget those things. Things that happen in our life, some things we just can't forget. But there's a difference between forgetting and forgiving. We can forgive, but we won't forget. Remember, I once said, you learn from your past, but you live in the present. And you look to the future. Joseph could never forget all those things, but he chose to forget the pain. And he refuses to harbor bitterness or hatred in his heart toward anyone. He bans the pain of the past. So he's able to do this for a couple of reasons. Number one is, listen, you can't change the past. You can't change what has happened in your life in the past. And secondly, it's God's place to avenge, not ours. Joseph didn't have a Bible at the time. The New Testament hadn't been written at the time, so he could not have read this verse, but yet he knows God's heart. And he knows God's words that Paul wrote in Romans chapter 12, verse 19, the last part of verse 19. It says, beloved, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Vengeance is God's, not ours. And we need to remember that it is impossible for us to enjoy our present blessings if we're unwilling to forget the pain of the past and the hurt of the past. The second son that Joseph named is Ephraim. Ephraim in the Hebrew means doubly faithful. Joseph knows, or doubly fruitful, I'm sorry, doubly fruitful, because he knows this. No one can be fruitful until he's willing to forgive. You cannot be fruitful in your life until you're willing to forgive. Harboring bitterness only causes problems in your life. Emotional problems, psychological problems, physical problems. Forgive first. Then God can bless your life. Can't be happy in the present, no matter what your blessings, unless you're willing to forget the pain of the past and forgive those responsible. Some of you have heard me tell this story before, but I'll share it again for those of you who are new. I was pastoring a church in Everett, Washington, and I was working also part-time at the local Providence Hospital there as a chaplain, on the chaplain staff. And there was a doctor there that did not like chaplains at all. In fact, he did not want any chaplains visiting his patients. So one night I'm sitting in the office. I had the what they call the evening shift. I was sitting in the office after I'd made some rounds and sitting in the office, and I got a phone call. And the nurse up on one of the floors said, "Chaplain, can you come up for a moment? We need to see you." And I said, "Oh, fine, I'll be right up." So I went right up, and she says, "I can't explain it to you, but I want you to read what is in this lady's chart." And I says, "Okay." So I read the chart, and I recognized the handwriting right away. It was that doctor's handwriting. And it said, "Patient has presented herself ambulatory." In other words, she couldn't walk. She came in by ambulance. "Unable to walk, severe back pain." And says, "We have run all the tests that we could. We have tried to determine the cause, and we can't find the physical cause for this." Says, "The doctors have had their go at it, if you will. Let the chaplain take his try." Sound like a challenge to me. So I went in with a young lady and I introduced myself and was talking to her for a while and found out, first of all, she was from a Mormon background. Secondly, she was not saved. She didn't know Christ as her personal Lord and Savior. And thirdly, as a young child, she had been abused physically and sexually by her father. And she had this bitterness in her that she just like hated him. Very bitter. Well, the first issue that we dealt with was her relationship with the Lord. That's very important. That's where you have to start. And she that night, she prayed. She accepted Christ as her Savior. And then I was explaining to her about what bitterness, harboring bitterness, does in your life and how it can be the cause of the pain that she's having. And I said, "You really need to forgive your father. You don't you know, you don't have to forget what happened, because you probably never will. But you need to let that go and let God take that. You need to forgive your dad. And you need to call him. Or if you just can't call him, at least write him a letter and let him know that you've forgiven him for what he's done to you in the past. She said, I could never do that. And I said, well, why don't you think about it, pray about it tonight. I'm going to come in tomorrow morning and see you again, if that would be all right with you. And she said, yeah, that'd be fine. Now, understand, she was in so much pain, she couldn't get out of bed to go anywhere, to do anything. And so I leave. The next morning, I came in just to see her, and came in about 8 o'clock that morning and walked into the room, and it's empty. The bed's all made up. It's clear. My first thought is, did she pass away in the middle of the night? What happened? And I walked out to the nurse's station. I says, nurse, what's going on here? She says, oh. She says, Rick, you'll never believe this. I said, try me. She says, not a half hour, 40 minutes after you left, she asked if she could use the telephone. And I said, sure. And she had me call the number for her. She called her dad. And she said, I left, but I could hear her crying, sobbing, talking to her dad on the phone. And then she hung up. She says, soon after that, she got up out of bed, got dressed, checked herself out of the hospital, walked out of the hospital, totally healed. Bitterness in your body, in your lives, will cause that, folks. Don't harbor bitterness. Give forgiveness. So now, back to Joseph. Joseph refused to harbor bitterness. But he didn't forget the pain of the past. He just he banned it, got rid of it. You don't forget those things. But forgiveness is so important. So when the 7 years of abundance came to an end, then 7 years of bad began, 7 years of famine. And it was so severe that it extended itself beyond the borders of Egypt to other countries. Other countries who had not prepared for it. So the bordering countries, they would come to Egypt to buy grain because Egypt had so much. I think God was setting up the stage for the next episode in the life of Joseph. Joseph teaches us the truth of maximizing our life, getting the most out of our life. It comes, folks, from a willingness to forgive. A willingness to forgive. And I think Joseph is a wonderful example of the promise that we have in Psalm 106. In Psalm 106, verse 3, the Bible says, "Blessed are those who keep justice, and he who does righteousness at all times." Joseph did what was righteous when he was willing to forget the pain of the past. I remember that shortly after I got out of the military in Hawaii, that I went to work for a company called Holiday Mart, and I worked in the jewelry department for that particular company. And I know that at the end of each evening before we closed up, that we would check the register tape And we would, which had all the sales of the day recorded. And then we would put that away, we'd file that. And the last thing that we did, I remember, the last thing that we did at the end of the night was to clear the register. Clear the register, and then we would begin the next day all fresh from the very beginning. You ever do that in your business? Yeah. You know what I'm talking about. And we would be undistracted by previous day's transactions. Folks, listen. Forgetting or banning the pain of the past is just like that. We have to clear our mental register of the past transactions. That includes the hurts that will result in bitterness and even to the point of hatred towards others. Sometimes the hurtful transactions are hidden in our hearts because we've ignored them so long. We've pushed them down, suppressed them so much. So what should we do about that? I believe there's a passage of Scripture that really gives us the answer. Psalm 139, verse 23. Search me, O God, and know my heart. See if there is any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. God, search my heart. Am I harboring bitterness in my heart towards someone? Is there any unforgiveness? Do I need to go to someone and make it right with them? Because until you make it right with them, you'll not be right with God. Maximizing our life. Getting the most out of our life, first of all, requires a right relationship with God through Christ. But then it requires that you plan for the future and that you ban the pain of the past. And leave it in the hands of God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we learn so much from the life of Joseph. All that he went through in his life, the unfair treatment that he received, the hurts, the pains that he suffered, and how easy it would have been for him to be bitter, unforgiving. But what an example he has set for us, Lord. Knowing that we need so much to plan for our future, but we also need to ban, to get rid of the pain of the past and to forgive. And Father, help us to do that. And just as the psalmist prayed, search our hearts, O God. Is there anything in our hearts, Lord, that would cause us not to have a right relationship with you, that would cause your blessings to be withheld? Show us, Lord. And then, Father, may we have your equipping grace and your empowering grace to go and make it right. Thank you, Father, for this time that we've come together. Thank you for those that are here. And now, Father, I pray that as we have shared from your word, that you would give us the understanding and the insight And then the wisdom, Lord. Grant us the wisdom to apply these principles to our lives. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Let's please stand together. And sing our, what's it called, a doxology, huh?
Right.
All right.
Praise God the
Lord,
who always sings low. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Hey, God bless you. Have a wonderful week. Look forward to seeing you back next Sunday morning. And by the way, next Sunday morning, let's see what I had here written down. For next Sunday morning, if sometime during this week, if you'll read the 42nd chapter of Genesis, Genesis chapter 42, and we're going to talk about how to keep a clear conscience.